Allahu Akbar.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I am your brother Nuh. I am a khatib, filmmaker, and student of knowledge from the so-called SoCal area. I am moderating the session, What in the World? Okay, so the first person that we have up is a sister by the name of Mindful Muslimah. And she is the host of a top 5-star rated Muslim podcast called Mindful Muslimah Speaks. She is a licensed educator with 20 years of experience in teaching and a hardworking mom of 5 beautiful people ages 3 to 23. So we welcome you, my dear sister, and we thank you for being a part of the broadcast, and we appreciate any knowledge that you have to share.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Alhamdulillah, I'm very honored actually, alhamdulillah. Bismillah, Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa hlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I think like many girls, when I was young, my mom, she told me, be honest. Be honest about everything and tell the truth no matter what the cost. But the truth is, many of us, as young girls, that's very scary because we care very much about what people think. We care very much about what society says about us. And yet still, we're told to still tell the truth and tell our story. So subhanAllah, I think what I want to start with that in saying is many of us, we are so worried about our young girls. We're so worried about them being made to feel like they have to question and reevaluate themselves for everything. Why they wear hijab, why they have this circle of friends, or they can't, hang out with men, or they can't do this. They're asked to reconsider everything. And when I say everything, you and I both know these days we mean everything, subhanAllah. And at times it can feel a bit hopeless. It can feel like, subhanAllah, how are we supposed to support these women when so much is coming at them on so many angles? But I want to tell you, as difficult as it seems, alhamdulillah, there is hope. And what I want us to know as a Muslim community is, alhamdulillah, by the barakah of Allah, by the mercy of Allah, the answers to so many things are actually right in our hand. They're right in our control. They don't feel that way, but they are, alhamdulillah, many of them. And so inshallah ta'ala, I want to share them with you today, but I do want to be honest. This is a very heavy topic. This is not something you can cover in 15 minutes. And so to make it kind of easy and light and at the same time hit the points home that we need, I want to do it in a bit of a powerful story, if you don't mind. And I'm going to tell you a story of a sister named Zainab. Obviously, that's not her real name because I would want to protect my sister. But instead of going through her entire situation, I'm only going to pull out the parts of the stories, alhamdulillah, that are related directly to this type of situation. So Zainab came from a really good family, alhamdulillah. Her parents did all they could to give her the best of education. You know, they supported her. They sent her to the masjid. You know, the parents prayed. They were polite to the community, alhamdulillah. But the thing is this, as much as they tried so hard to be good and bring her up in a Western society, some of the things that they were doing were very much cultural perspectives, not necessarily Islamic, but cultural perspectives. And so Zainab experienced a lot. And I'm just going to be highlighting just a couple points from different points in her life up to what is now relevant that I think we need to pay a little bit more attention to and open our hearts to, alhamdulillah. So the first thing is, when Zainab was a child, alhamdulillah, she, you know, her parents tried to keep her in line, but everything was haram. She didn't quite know why, but she knew if she did certain things, it's absolutely haram, and she didn't really understand the depth of it. And that goes into the second part of her childhood. Zainab was never really explained to why she could do this, why she couldn't do that. It was just known that it was forbidden for her. And lastly, when Zainab was young, she experienced a lot of issues with her weight. Maybe she wasn't as skinny as the other cousins, and everybody kind of taunted her a bit about it. And subhanAllah, they would do it with a good heart because they wanted to help her, and they thought, maybe if I just tell her she's fat and she needs to lose weight and she needs to do this, maybe subhanAllah, she will lose the weight. And Zainab, you know how that could feel to a young girl. And subhanAllah, no one ever interjected on Zainab's behalf. Now, as Zainab went into her adolescence, now she's going into a teenager, obviously it gets even harder for her, right? As Zainab approached her adolescence, she experienced many more things. And subhanAllah, you know, the pressure to be skinny and beautiful, only got worse, you know? Even she would go to regular weddings with her family, and subhanAllah, the pressure to dress up and to look good and to feel like you could be as beautiful as the other girls in the room, that was a real thing, because at that age, that's all we care about, right? SubhanAllah. And, you know, because of this, subhanAllah, her clothes, they got tighter and tighter and a bit more revealing, because she needed to feel beautiful, subhanAllah, right? Then again, at this point, Zainab still didn't have a real understanding of why. She didn't still even know why she wore hijab. She didn't even know why she couldn't date like everyone else did. Like, why is it that we can't? She didn't understand why she couldn't have a guy friend, because she felt like she knew her limits. Like, what was the problem? The question of why kept coming in her head, but everything was just like, It's haram, subhanAllah. Now, the other thing I want to just mention in finishing up this part of the story is the mixed messages. As Zainab went to school every day, doesn't matter if we're talking Islamic or public here, and I'll be very honest about that, because I have helped to teach and manage in both situations, alhamdulillah. The mixed messages are real, right? You're not allowed to do this, but then when you get to school, it's a whole other situation. And so she felt very impressionable, and she didn't have anyone to discuss this mixed emotion. And the last thing is, she was really, really evident in her family. What the rest of the family, what the rest of society thought about them and their family was key. It was always a pressure for her not to talk too loud, not to make a scene, not to make people think anything about them and their family. And subhanAllah, it went on. Now, the last thing I'll mention about this is the social media. Obviously, at a teenager age, this is something that is right in front of your face. And, you know, everyone in that state of social media, we have to look amazing. Everybody has to front that we are having our whole act together. We're beautiful every day. We're happy every day. And so she felt the need to post regardless of what she was going through and truly felt. Now, as Zainab barely survived her adolescence and teenage years, and she went into college and all rolled in, and she went into university, it was this high pressure for her to be marriageable material, right? Her parents needed her to get a degree so she can get into law or medical school. And, you know, they pressured her to have phenomenal grades so that a potential guy of a good family who also would graduate with a law, medical degree, engineering, would come and marry her, you know, subhanAllah. And this pressure to please everyone was really, really great. And then obviously her friends. As Zainab was trying to balance this act of school and pleasing her parents and understanding herself, her friends, the influence was always there. And no matter what she did, you know, guys were everywhere and everybody was hanging out with them. So at first it felt awkward, but eventually as she's exposed day after day, it started to feel normalized. And so she engaged. And subhanAllah, again, the social media, the Snapchat, the TikTok, the pressure to go on every day and to look good, be happy, and even obviously dance in TikTok, we know now, subhanAllah, a'udhu billah, and in front of everyone and show what you have was a very real thing for her. Now, I'm going to fast forward in this last part of Zainab's story, because in all honesty, that part of the story is not for this setting, but we know many things happen. And I want us to know that Zainab made many bad decisions because she was utterly torn into two worlds. And subhanAllah, she felt empty no matter what she did. She felt like she wasn't good enough. She would go to the masjid and, you know, subhanAllah, people looked at her one way. And she would go on social media and she would feel happy, you know, a minute to post something happy, but then she would also feel sick because she knew that wasn't who she was, but she had to get up and look good every day for that. And subhanAllah, she even was secretly ashamed of what she did. But who could she talk to? And I want us to think about this for our women. Who could she talk to? Her mom? Her mom didn't understand these two worlds. And her imam, our spiritual leader, I can't talk to him about these things that I'm doing, subhanAllah, she thought. Her friends? Well, she knew secretly in her heart, they were a bit as broken as she was at the time. And what about these guys that were interested in her? SubhanAllah, she knew and understood that they actually just wanted something from her. So in the end, Zainab had no one. She had no one. And so one night, just to end the story, in a fit of desperation, she went into her room and she closed the door and she dove into sujood, and with her face pressed to the carpet and her eyes, just tears everywhere. The carpet is wet with her tears. She prayed out to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, you know, help me. I am trying to make everybody, you know, to understand me. I don't understand me. I don't know what to do. I'm not happy. Nobody's happy with me. Ya Allah, help me. And so she cries and she cries into the carpet. And as she's crying, because, you know, alhamdulillah, she did hear Quran in her house. An ayah of Quran came with her. Subhanallah. And the ayah of Quran that came to her was, and be not like those who forgot Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he made them forget their own soul. And it was in that moment of realization that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought something to Zainab. Because you see, we have to understand, brothers and sisters, there is a place in the qalb that we can try all as much as we can to fill it with social media, to fill it with gatherings, to fill it with, you know, all kinds of things, a'udhu billah, that we might do, right? Netflix series, TikTok swiping, a'udhu billah. We can try as much as we can. But if we have that void, we have that hole. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not part of our life in the way that he should be. He can't be when we get time at the end of the day. Then, subhanAllah, the soul always feels at a state of unrest. And this is what Zainab was experiencing. Now, I'm going to stop right here at Zainab's story to finish up and to give you a solution, because I think this is a serious problem we're not realizing. And I want now to draw us to outside of Zainab for a moment as we finish. You know, subhanAllah, I want you to imagine right now Zainab is in a state of complete vulnerability. Years and years of questioning herself and her identity, and over and messages, who should I please? My family, my friends, what should I, where do I belong and what is my identity? After years of that, she's in a vulnerable state. Now, what's happening is this process is not overnight. This has taken years. And this is what I want people to understand about our women and the state of our women when we look at them on social media. This is happening from childhood to adolescence into the college years. And subhanAllah, they're in a state of vulnerability. And guess what happens? In walks outsiders coming to tell them and convince them that Islam is their problem. Islam is their problem. But that's not true, a'udhu billah. And they're being told if they shed themselves of their Islam, their problems will go away, right? Subhanallah, a'udhu billah. And that the more they shed layer after layer of clothing, subhanallah, then they will have a better experience and they will be free. But we know what the truth is, brother and sister, right? No matter how many layers of clothes us women can take off, a'udhu billah, we can never shed our fitrah. This is something inside of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so as these women succumb to these suggestions from outside of themselves, what we notice is that they don't feel better. And that's because of that, right? And so subhanAllah, I want to end with stating this problem very clearly for us of what is happening and how it's progressing. And then just, I want to give you 4 points of very realistic and practical solutions, because I'm very realistic and practical. I believe that theory will not help us in this state, right? SubhanAllah. Only. And so the real problem is the pressure on our girls is unreal. And I'm not just talking about the young girls. I'm talking about the married women and subhanAllah, all of us in this society. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has his standard for us that he measures us and our worth. And, you know, for some reason, I think we have it upside down, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not measure a sister by her weight. He does not measure a sister's worth by her degree or by, you know, her husband's degree that she gets or the outfit she's wearing at her cousin's wedding or how many guys want to marry her or the quality of her latest Instagram post or her TikTok and Snapchat status views and likes. This is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking for in determining our worth. And yet, as a community, we have these empty standards and pressures that we put on ourselves and one another. And subhanAllah, what I want to say is that as women in the community, we have to support one another. I want to insert a small story just right here. One sister, you know, actually many sisters, they DM me on Instagram regularly with the company that I have. And subhanAllah, you know, we support women. And they're coming to us like, sister, the pressure. Do you know when I put out podcasts, one of the number one podcasts that I put out is how to stop caring about what other people think. Now, I want us to think about that for a minute. I'm putting out podcasts regularly for women on all the topics they care about. And subhanAllah, one of the ones women listen to is this. And other ones are about how to stop being depressed. And another top podcast, the one where I get high views, is how to stop having suicidal thoughts. I want us to understand the real state of our women right now. Because what I want us to understand is there is a state of vulnerability. And I want us to acknowledge the fact that there are real solutions that we need to take now. So what happens is, I want to just give you the work solutions, very practical solutions I want us as a community to take out of Zainab's story and move on. One is the foundation. We need to ensure that in our homes, we have a secure foundation for our women. If the aqidah of our families is intact, then they are not going out in a state of vulnerability. Then when people approach them with ideas that their Islam is their problem, and subhanAllah, this is not something that can creep into their head. So I want us to think a bit more in the way that we approach about that. And within that foundation, making sure that our girls' self-esteem is strong. If we get to the root of many of these problems, it comes down to self-esteem and their sense of worth. And that's something we need to build more. Number two, over-pleasing the people and not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have too much emphasis on doing this. And as we say, we love Allah and we're pleasing Allah, but what are our actions doing? When we make decisions to do what our auntie wants, we know isn't following the sunnah, but we don't want to upset her. You know, or are we going to go to a wedding scandalously dressed because we're worried about the people will look at us when we know it's aib and it's not appropriate? You know, things like this are, we have to be in alignment with our culture and our Islam. Number three, exposure. I want parents to take this very seriously. Many of them, they're giving their children devices for hours on end. I know COVID, it's worse, guys. I know it's worse. SubhanAllah, I'm an educator. I see, I hear all the time. But understand something. We're putting the world in the palm of their hand. Everything good and everything bad in it. And with hours of it, and you know, the more, the older they get, the less we are monitoring them. When's the last time we checked these things, you know, on their devices? Many parents, they don't. They don't even know how to use some of them. And lastly, the realistic and practical resources. So many of our women, they want to come back. They want to realign themselves. But the problem is that, subhanAllah, they don't actually know the how-to. And I just want this to be clear to people. They want this step-by-step. We can't tell them to have patience, to wait, to do this. They say, how? Show me. So, and one of the things I do in Mindful Muslimah is we create these resources and tools, giving them the step-by-step. We work with the parents to create the Islamic home. But I want the community to understand there are not enough resources catered to our particular situation. And I just want to encourage the rest of the community to create these as well. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept all of our efforts, to help us to support one another, and to help us to create an environment for our women that only support them in their identity as Muslim women. Alhamdulillah.
Ameen. Allahumma ameen. MashaAllah, dear sister, I appreciate you sharing that with us. I would encourage you to continue with your podcast. The Muslim sisters need you at this point. They definitely need you. Like you said, with the problem of women taking off their hijabs and the pressure from the media and who they put on a pedestal as role models, your voice needs to be heard. And I thank ICNA for giving you this platform. Everybody continue to donate to ICNA.org/donate. And I appreciate you. And for our dear sister, the Mindful of Muslimah. So we see that there's a lot of pressure that young women face to wear hijab. Do you see any commonalities of the women who wear hijab, or commonalities in women who don't wear hijab but who have taken off their hijab?
Salah, I think it would be unfair for me to make a sweeping generalization for all of our sisters. However, what I will say is that we shouldn't be deceived by one another. I remember Rasulullah, there's a point that he talks about where, you know, we think that our exterior expresses everything about ourselves. No, don't get me wrong. It does say something about our Islam. But at the same time, sometimes I know sisters that they will wear hijab and there are many things they're doing that are not very Islamic, and there are sisters who don't, and they're actually like sometimes they're reverts and they want to become Muslims and they're engaging in, but they're just not there yet. So I would say that the biggest thing I would love to see sisters do is to give one another the benefit of the doubt, because actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we don't know the hearts of one another. And at the end of the day, sometimes, especially as we're meeting one another very fast, we will make a quick judgment. We all do it. As soon as we see someone flash on the screen, oh, this one, she's religious. Look how she's dressed. This one, she's not. And I think it says something about us, not about them. I think we need to withhold, find out more about one another. So I don't want to say, because I don't know every woman, Allahu alam. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for all of us to be at the best level of our Islams regardless. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah.
Ameen. Jazakallah khair. Jazakallah khair. Thank you for that. Thank you for that answer. And may Allah bless and protect us and keep us rightly guided in the Sirat al-Mustaqim. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم وليس على المسلمين فاستغفروا فإنه هو غفور رحيم السلام عليكم.